Good morning. Beloved, we gather in worship today to lift up our voices and to call out to God. We cry out believing that God hears us. So I invite all of us to quiet our minds, prepare for worship, as we're ready to lift our voices in song, prayer, and the preached word. I invite you, as you are able, to stand as we sing our congregational introit. Carl will play it through once, and then we will join in on the second time. Our call to worship is found on your bulletin. It is adapted from Psalm 41. Happy are those who consider the poor. The Lord protects them and keeps them alive. Help us, Lord, to consider the poor. Our opening hymn is hymn 28, Holy God, we praise your name. Beloved, let us ask to be forgiven for the times when we have chosen badly, opting for the easy way of habit and social convention rather than the higher and harder way of Jesus. Let us pray our prayer of confession. Holy One, you have called to us, and so we have gathered as your people. Here in your presence, we recognize and confess that we have failed to be faithful to you. We have not loved you with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we long to turn back to the way that leads to life. For the sake of Jesus Christ, forgive us and free us for life as you intended. We pray in Christ's name as we pray in his words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Sometimes we do make the wrong choice. But the good news, beloved, as the psalmist reminds us in Psalm 103, is that God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, the type of love that is faithful even when we aren't. There is room for us to grow. There are opportunities for us to get it right. With that good news in mind, let us sing. Please be seated. Beloved, leading up to our passage for this morning, Jesus has been teaching, and essentially he says that we as people cannot serve both God and wealth. And when he makes that statement, the gospel writer Luke observes that some of the Pharisees, some people who were scribes and lawyers, hear that statement, and because they were lovers of money themselves, they laugh and make fun of Jesus. Then Jesus, who always seems to have a story up his sleeve, tells this one. Hear this word from the gospel according to Luke. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died, and he was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side, he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." He said, "Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." May the Lord add a blessing and understanding to this reading of Scripture. Our worship continues as we are led by the Hallelujah and Treble Choirs. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah and Treble Choirs, thank you so much for leading us in worship will you do us a favor and lead the way to church school? Children are always welcome here in worship at Plymouth Church, but we also have incredible Christian education in our church school. We invite you to make your way there if you choose so.
Everyone, and welcome to Plymouth Church. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are always welcome here, and we are so glad to have you with us today. Here at Plymouth, our mission is to grow in love of God and neighbor, and we do that by getting to know each other. And one way that we do that is by inviting you to sign the red friendship pads located in the center of each aisle. It's a good way for you to learn the names of those around you, and it helps us as staff to know who worshiped with us today. Also located in those red friendship pads are pastoral care sheets and prayer sheets. If you or someone that you know is in need of prayer or pastoral care, please fill out the appropriate sheet. You can put it in the offering plate later during service, or you can hand it to a deacon or a minister on your way out. We really do believe in the power of prayer here, and we're deliberate in lifting each other up. After worship, don't run out of the building too fast. Come to Waveland Hall for some more fellowship over refreshments. And our visitors, please make your way to the comma-shaped desk outside of these doors. We have a special gift for you, and we want to welcome you, so please stop by. I have a few quick announcements. Our Lenten Vespers worship services continue each Thursday at 5:30 p.m. in the sanctuary. Our last Vesper service is April the 6th, so come out and hear a word from the Lord. A delegation from Plymouth is headed to Havana, Cuba this Wednesday, March 29th, to celebrate the 70th anniversary of our sister church, Ebenezer Baptist Church. Let us keep them in our hearts and our thoughts and prayers as they travel international waters. Parents of children in K through second grade who are attending Our Whole Lives class, today's class will meet from 11:30 to 12:15 so that the kinder choir and the cherub choirs are able to sing in the 11 o'clock worship service. Next week's classes will meet at the usual time. We have a special announcement from our matins, Caroline and Wyatt Johnson.
Hi, my name is Wyatt Johnson.
And I'm Caroline Johnson.
We're here to tell you about one of the most amazing retail extravaganzas of the new spring season.
That's right. It's time for the annual Matins Garage Sale. We'll have clothes, furniture of all sorts, toys, sporting gear, home decor, dishes, books, records, maybe even millinery.
Millinery?
Hats.
Right. Anyway, the sale will be Friday, April 7th, and Saturday, April 8th. But you can start dropping off your gently used treasures at church, downstairs by the gym, beginning 1 week from today, April 2nd, starting at 12:30 p.m., and continuing all week before the big sale.
One more thing. This year, the Matins tour goes all the way to the Adirondacks. Not gonna lie, we're gonna need a lot of gas for the buses, so we're going to need a lot of donations and a lot of shoppers.
Look for more about the sale, dates for donating, and shopping in the bulletin.
Donate, volunteer to help the sale, and shop. And thanks for supporting Matins.
Next Sunday at 11 a.m. is a special service of music and reflections on Ubi Caritas. The chancel choir will sing, and Matt will reflect on each line of the ancient chant. So join us and bring a friend to church. Remember to peruse your current happenings. It's full of exciting opportunities and events happening inside and outside of these walls, and we do not want you to miss out. I think that about covers it for announcements, so let us continue to worship God, being led by song. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. First, in the stillness of silence, creating space for God's Spirit to dwell. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, each of us in this room comes to you with different concerns that burden our hearts and trouble our spirits. So we bring the brokenness of our hearts before your altar, asking that your peace and love be made known to us. Lord, so often we want to be close to you, yet you feel so far away from us. In these moments, we ask that you cradle us in your ever-reaching arms and give us the wisdom to know you above all others. We pray for those who are struggling to find their way, who may be experiencing deep loss in their lives right now. We pray that you will bless them with your healing touch. We also pray for those who are experiencing sickness and injury, God. May your peace be made known to them. Heal us in this place. Guide us with your grace. Remind us of our beauty and who you've created us to be, and help us to acknowledge and appreciate the beauty of all of your creation. And Lord, you are still speaking to us, so we thank you for those that you've sent who walk among us, challenging us to love deeply and more compassionately. May we be encouraged to stand together, holding each other tenderly as we continue to travel life's journey together. We thank you, God, for the beauty that you've made known to us as we watch the sunrise and set. As we witness the seasons change, help us to accept the inevitability of change in our own lives while recognizing its unique beauty and purpose. Give us the courage and strength to let go of the things that we cannot change, while empowering us to be the change that we wish to see. Help us to connect more deeply to each other. Give us the audacity to be honest and vulnerable with those in our lives about our hopes and our fears. We thank you, God, for continuous opportunities to be loved, for handshakes and hugs, high fives and gentle touches that bring us closer to each other. We thank you that you love us enough that you won't stop speaking to us, even when we don't want to hear from you. So, Lord, give us the ears that are discerning so that we may recognize your voice above all the other chatter in the wind. Help us to be more like you. Help us to love more like you. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. may be seated. Good morning. People of God, will you pray with me, please? Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A Christmas carol for Lent. That's what I'm calling this morning's message. Reading the parable about the rich man and Lazarus got me wondering about how familiar Charles Dickens was with this scripture when he crafted his tale where Jacob Marley warns Scrooge of the dangers of his humbuggery and utter disregard for the poor from beyond the grave. Before we jump into that, before we go too far, I want to back up a minute to talk about hell. Because in this parable, Jesus does. I don't actually think that's the point of this parable. We'll get to that soon. But hell is the setting for much of this parable, the rich man in Hades, thirsting for a drink. And I think no matter how you read it, any mention of hell is an easy place to get hung up, a trap to fall into, and a way to miss what I think this story is really about. So let me say a couple of things about that. First, let me say that I know hell is real because I know people who have been there. I know people who have spent a significant time in a living hell, like Lazarus, the poor man in this parable, who in his earthly life dreams of a real meal while languishing outside the rich man's gates, his body covered in sores that attract the mangy mutts on the streets who come and use him as a human salt lick. I don't know anyone with a story quite like Lazarus, but I know plenty of people who have been to hell and back. Second, I don't know whether Jesus believed in hell as an eternal destination, but I will tell you why I don't and why I think this parable bears this out. This season that we're in, this Lenten season where Jesus is pointing his face toward Jerusalem, is the season where Jesus prepares for the passion, for his own suffering on the cross, out of compassion for the people, standing in solidarity with those who suffer. Jesus's compassion, an echo and an embodiment of God's defining trait. Jesus's compassion means that no one is left to eternal solitary suffering. I don't believe in hell as an eternal destination because I know our God to be a God of compassion. But I do believe in hell as an effective literary device. That's what I think Jesus is doing here. Anyone who's spent a little time in a living hell knows they don't want to spend more time there. So to hear about a rich man going to hell while a poor man was taken unto the bosom of Abraham to experience heavenly bliss would have completely thwarted the expectations of Jesus' first century listeners. There is a kind of early prosperity gospel understanding of life and blessing operating in Jesus' day. If you were prosperous as the rich man was, if you could dress in purple linen and secure your house with gates and feast sumptuously every single day, people just assumed that that meant you had received God's favor. You were hashtag blessed. On the other hand, if you were poor and hungry and covered in sores that made you ritually unclean and cast you outside the web of community, it must mean you'd done something terribly wrong. If the rich were blessed, the poor must be cursed. with better stewardship of their resources, or a better work ethic, or just a little more bootstrapping, basically with just a little more righteousness, the poor could be blessed too. But in this parable, Jesus turns this understanding of blessing and curse on its head, showing his disciples, showing the Pharisees, and showing us how God's compassion really works. He hails back to the Beatitudes, "Blessed are the poor," reminding us that if the gospel is to be good news, it must be good news for the poor. No one helped Lazarus in his earthly life, but after a lifetime of human neglect, God helps him. In fact, his name means God helps. At his death, Lazarus is taken up to the bosom of Abraham. People would have been surprised to hear about a sick beggar going to heaven, surprised to hear that God's compassion works like that. In this parable, Jesus avoids the common pitfall of blaming the victim. Instead, he acknowledges the great chasm that we set up between ourselves and those experiencing poverty, as if to keep from catching it. Now, there's a temptation here to get drawn into the dichotomy of the "where will I end up" question. Am I good enough to end up with Lazarus? Am I bad or oblivious enough to end up with the rich man? But I think this parable is subtler than that and invites us into some more open-ended, holy imagining. It's not asking us to contemplate our eternal destination so much as it's asking us to re-examine our relationship to wealth, to God, and to our neighbors. And Jesus always calls for that not to be so much transactional, if I do X, then I'll get Y, but relational. What has God blessed me with that can help me bless the world? How can I share what I have and grow in relationship and love? This passage is part of a larger chapter, as David was talking about, that lifts up the impossibility of serving both God and wealth. It begins with Jesus addressing the disciples, but then the Pharisees start listening in, and they are described as lovers of money, serving wealth because they lack real confidence and trust in God. They don't really believe that God can show up for them in a time of need, so they store up their security elsewhere. And in so doing, they neglect those in need all around them. They forget that they might be God's way of blessing other people. And so as they listen to Jesus tell these stories about wealth, the grumbling they were doing as Jesus spoke of the lost sheep and coin and son, it turns to ridicule. Hearing this story of disordered relationship to wealth on the heels of the chapter dedicated to the parables of the lost being found and celebrated, those things of real value, it hits just a little too close to home for them. Talking about money, talking about our stuff, it can be really hard. It can lead to the kind of pushback and cynicism of the Pharisees because it makes us uncomfortable. But we don't need to be told that wealth can create divisions between people. We experience that. Whether it's the wall of envy or resentment that goes up when we see or hear about someone who has much more than we do, or the wall of shame or disdain or self-protection that goes up when we're in the presence of someone who has much less than we do and we're afraid they might ask for something we have. The divide that wealth creates can seem intractable. But even though in this story, in this parable, Abraham says that the divide between the rich man and Lazarus can't be crossed, Jesus tells the story. If that gap can't be crossed, what's the point? even though Abraham says, remember in life you received your good things and Lazarus received evil things, and this chasm is fixed, and your brothers have Moses and the prophets, and they should listen to them, and if they don't, they wouldn't even be convinced by someone who rose from the dead. Even though those words come from the mouth of Abraham in the story, Jesus, the teller of the story, puts them there. His voice raised from the dead, speaking to the living, to those like the brothers of the rich man, like the older brother in the prodigal son story last week, like Ebenezer Scrooge in A Christmas Carol. He speaks to those of us who have the ability to influence the way the story turns out, to those of us who have agency, to those of us who have a decision to make and maybe some repenting to do. The story isn't finished until we decide how we're going to hear it. And the mere telling of it by Jesus is an act of compassion, speaking the truth in love for those who still have a chance to hear and repent. It's as though he's taking down the wall, crossing that chasm, acting as a kind of Jacob Marley for all those who have ears to hear. I think this parable is inviting us not so much to identify with the rich man or Lazarus as with the five brothers of the rich man who still live. It's asking us to be the Ebenezer Scrooge of our own Lenten Christmas carol. Still in need of repentance, still living, still needing to heed the word of Moses and the prophets and Jesus in order to reorient and transform our relationship to our stuff and to each other. And Jesus is exhorting his listeners, exhorting us to examine our relationship to wealth and just how intractable it is, and our relationship to our neighbors. A few weeks ago, David and I were leading a confirmation theme night about the Christian practice of giving. Our focus was on time and talent as well as our treasure, but some of the best questions we got were about our relationship to our stuff. Why, some of the kids wondered, why are people so selfish? Is it bad to like your stuff? And do you have to be giving away things constantly to be a good Christian? These are good questions. It's not bad to like your stuff, to take pleasure in the good things of this world. But it is bad when we value our stuff above other people and above God. When those things get out of whack, we're not living in love. And it's hard because so much of our culture teaches and reinforces that idea of getting what we want, pursuing the hot new thing, reaching out, get what I want when I want it, or store it away in ever bigger barns or bank accounts to secure the future for my children while assuming that everyone else has access to the same resources. The way that Jesus asks us to relate to wealth, to let go of it and trust in God, is countercultural. In this parable, Jesus is calling us to repent where our relationship with our stuff and with our neighbors are out of alignment with God's call, with God's compassion, with God's charity and God's love. Ubi caritas et amor Deus ibi est. This is our Lenten theme. Where there is charity and love, God is there. Jesus' call for us to repent, it's actually an invitation to get closer to God, because when we turn toward greater charity, we are invited more deeply into God's presence and love. And when Jesus invites us to show this charity and to live in love, he's not just asking us to fling money at a problem to assuage our own guilt. He's inviting us to develop real relationships across difference. The need is not just for charity, but for a fundamental relationship with our neighbors. I was challenged and convicted by a recent interview with Pope Francis, in which he was questioned about almsgiving, especially to panhandlers. First, the interviewer wondered, should we do it? Should we give money to those who ask for it? And second, should we worry about how it is spent? Should we worry about it being wasted on alcohol or cigarettes or junk food or something worse? The Pope's answer chastened me, because I've often used the desire not to enable bad behavior as an excuse not to give when I didn't want to. But the Pope turned the question back on the interviewer. If a glass of wine is the only happiness he has in life, that's okay. Instead, ask yourself, what do you do on the sly? What happiness do you seek in secret? He wondered whether we might recognize our own blessing and share from our abundance instead of pushing our responsibility to help our neighbor onto someone else. Can we practice a compassion that is more than transactional? That's not just about getting what I've paid for when it comes to small service to the poor, but about connecting with another human being and honoring their dignity and worth. Can we cultivate a fundamental neighborliness, a deep knowledge of and concern for the well-being of our neighbors? Like Scrooge and Tiny Tim at the end of A Christmas Carol, can we cross the chasm that wealth creates and develop a real relationship? Recognizing it's not just about what we have to give, but what we have to gain. Like it was in the first century, the chasm between people that wealth creates is great. But Jesus is telling us this story out of compassion and love. Do you have ears to hear? Amen. People of God, one of the quickest ways to start putting our relationship to God and wealth in order is to let go of some of our stuff. When we practice this regularly, our spirits get accustomed to what's of real value and trust a little more deeply. So I invite you into this holy practice of giving as we worship God with our morning offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of charity and love, God who crosses every divide, pour out your blessing on these our offerings that they may build bridges and take down walls between people. Bless them to build up relationships through our Cuba delegation and to dismantle chasms between people through the work of our homeless assistance team. Bless them to connect us through the beauty of music in worship. God, we thank you for the ability to give with our time, our talent, and our treasure. We pray that you use these, our gifts, for your good in the world. We pray this all in your holy name. Amen. People of God, I pray that you go out from this place that knowing that when Jesus tells these stories, he tells them for you. I hope you have ears to hear and that as you go with this blessing. Now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.